We're gonna go ahead and get started. Appreciate everyone coming out this evening. We'll try to keep things on time and on task. Let's go ahead and start with introductions. Michael, if you'll start us off on your side of the table, please.
Sure, my name is Department of Health.
Robert Cannon. Ross County.
Charmaine Payne.
Lisa Bennett, Ross County.
Kristy Renner, Ross County Board Member.
Carl Arby, Board Member.
Sam Graff, Board Member.
Carlton Cave, Board Member.
Martha Cosley, Board Member.
Al Non-Cisco, Board Member.
Bob Berry, Vice Chair.
Will Henderson, Chair.
Bill Radburn, VDFO.
Greg Simonson, Federal Coordinator.
Eric Roberts, EHI, Support Staff, and part of the Administrative Staff here at the Board. Before we get rolling into the agenda, we're gonna have a brief introduction. Jeff, if you'll.
Oh yeah, I just got a new face to introduce, Jeff Stevens. Jeff is the new Site Deputy Director. I don't know if you heard, Floor 1 Idaho contract. So a couple folks from our team just left last week. That includes Fred Hughes, who was the Deputy Director, and then Mark Jewett, who's familiar to, I think, all of the Board members. And we did have John, and I just, John Law, who's in the OSDF Construction. They have all left, so Jeff has joined us. Jeff's very familiar with the site and with D&D, so I'll let him introduce himself.
Well, Mayor, I actually found the site when I got here, so I'm pretty happy about that. So supposedly Fred was originally going to introduce me, but he's not here. So then Dennis was going to introduce me, and he's not here. So he showed what kind of support he's getting from the guys working. But no, I appreciate it. Actually, it's great to be here. Like many of us, I've worked in the industry for, I don't know, 30, 35 years. Looked at my license, and so I'm like, yeah, it's only been about 20 years. But actually done quite a bit of D&D work around the country, a lot of it commercial work, as well as government work. One of my previous jobs, which I get to talk about here a lot, was I did three of the gas distribution plants in Oak Ridge several years ago. Actually, very similar, in some cases, in fact, duplicates of what we have here. So hopefully I can, if nothing else, bring, here's what we shouldn't do when we're doing this work here, and maybe a few things that we should. So I've been in the area about a month now, and getting to see a lot of the area. I've been coming up here on and off for about 10 years for different project, so at least I didn't know where Pike did and where they needed to chill about before. So, and Jackson, I spent a couple of nights in Jackson, so I'm getting around. But I look forward to seeing all of you folks around, and if you have anything, please let me know. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
It's
nice to have you on board. Especially if we can take you out for dinners, right? Is that how it always works? Is that?
You know, it's all an improvement.
I got you. Perfect. Outstanding. All right, so to the rest of the public, we want to welcome you guys here. This is the, I guess this is the first meeting we've had all year. Is that right? That's crazy, but we had January, right? And then snow and snow and more snow. And so we're up and ready to go. We would ask, if you're a member of the public, that if you would please sign in over at the back. You can see Dr. Menuda is demonstrating that for us right now. There's also a spot back there if you would like to designate, you would like time on the agenda for public comments. We invite you to provide your comments and address the way forward. But we do need you to sign up and make sure that you mark that box on the sign-in sheet so we set aside time for you. All right, first item on the agenda is review of the agenda. You'll see it's the big thing tonight is the budget discussion. President's fiscal year 2017 request. Is there anything else that needs to be added to the agenda for tonight? All right, seeing none, looking for a motion to proceed with the agenda as presented. Sam? All right, is there a second? All right, Martha, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Okay, so all the way back to January, we got the board meeting, and the copy of the minutes are under tab 240. Give you guys just a second to review those. corrections that need to be made to this. All right, any changes or corrections? How about a motion to accept as presented? All right, all right. We have a motion to accept it. Second from Carlton. All those in favor of accepting the minutes as presented, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, we're going to hand the reins over to Joel for his evening of vote presentation.
Hey, thank you, Eric.
Yes, sir.
Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so welcome, everybody. So first thing, congratulations on order for the board. I recognized this year at the Todd County Chamber banquet as the 2015 Organization of the Year. So I say good job. Great recognition and good representation by board members, and Will did a good job, you know, accepting on behalf of everybody. And so you guys do, everybody's taking notice, and you know, people always notice. So you kind of see the folks who represented the award there at the bottom of the picture, and maybe some pictures of past members. And so I'll just say, you know, congrats. Well, and people take notice, so it's well deserved. All right, now on with the rest. Talk a little bit about, as usual, safety, some plan updates, community outreach, upcoming events. So, first thing on safety. So, I'll say that the site is doing much better on safety. Things are, you know, we talked about. Safety events and trending up, we typically measure our performance in safe work hours. And so you might imagine that metric is, you know, how many hours collectively everybody works on site versus an event. So SSAB has gotten in over 2 million work hours without a lost time accident. So they're doing very well. We are currently trending down below, so EM has some targets. For the entire complex, we've been above those for the last several months, and so these current past 2 months, we're actually below target. So safety performance is going well, so it's that's a credit to the folks there that do the job day in, day out. All right, now, this is back on kind of the integrated baseline we pitch out. So this really addresses, you know, our big basic chunks of work, and let me give you a status. So before I walk in and talk about each individual project, just want to bring this up on the screen and so allow you to put it in perspective. So as we talk about, the job really is about D&D, on-site disposal, our soil excavation, and then property transfer. So, and I'll touch a little bit of all of those things as I go through the presentation. You can kind of see the marker up there. It gives you some indication of current date that we're on. And the next slide is the 3/20/60 activation. So,
it's just a corner. Yeah.
Can I put my hat with this thing?
Greg's up. All right. So, 3/20/60 activation. So, remember the first thing, the D&D chunk of work right there. So, here's 3/20/60 activation. All right. So. It's reasonably on task. If you go back, you can flip back just a little bit. What's like that? So you will see that one. 3/20/60 activation. Okay, so we're looking and hoping to have 3/20/60 activation complete in 2017. Okay, now you flip forward just a second. The majority of that work, there you go, is probably. The bulk of the heavy lift of that is process gas equipment removal, okay?
And the folks have been working really hard to complete that work, which is primarily on the second floor of that process building. There's a bunch of stuff downstairs too, but not nearly as much as there are upstairs. And so, relatively speaking, I'll say we're reasonably on track to complete it in 2017. Probably from a deactivation from all the equipment standpoint and doing the measurements and the characterization work, we're probably, you know, 3-4 months or so behind where we want to be, but the consensus is that we have an opportunity to make it up, but certainly finishing it up reasonably on schedule is still on the table. Next slide. On-site disposal facility. So if you've been driving out there Fog Road or made some of the other tours out there, you'll notice it's changed a lot. And so the folks out there have done a great job. I know we talked a little bit about it. There used to be a bunch of trees here, which now you'll see none. So about 205 acres of trees taken care of. One local company came in and took care of that. Great job, very safely done, and the place actually looks better after they've left it than my yard typically does. So again, another good job, safely done. The other piece that we've kind of talked about a little bit, and it was back up there on the schedule, which you have in front of you, so you refer back to it, is the firing range demo, which is kind of in the footprint. And so part of that was going through, and as you imagine, there's a lot of spent rounds up there, just because, right? And so the first piece was going and cleaning up, getting the lead out, okay? And then now prep for there's a little structure up there for the deactivation of that structure, and then subsequent demolition of that structure to continue on with their site preparations for the on-site disposal cell. And I might mention that a lot of the grass was donated, given to SODI for recycling. So as it comes up, we can recycle material. That's part of the plan. Next slide. So all that works, we still have a site to maintain, and so you can see some of the big activities that are going on site. We're doing a lot of work in replacing and repairing some of the infrastructure on site. Our focus is on the fire suppression system. So we have as you might imagine, a lot of below ground fire systems. We have two out there, and if you drive by and see the two towers out there, that's what they support. And so what we're doing is we've identified previously hydrants that don't work, and so we're investing in repairing those and making sure the system is maintained. It's an old system like we talked about, so there's a lot of work there, but we've got folks repairing hydrants out there and other portions of the fire suppression system. Also, continue to do some work on the overhead power lines, some additional 13-8 work. And let's see, here, if you drove by the Cloverleaf, you came in that way where you would see the DOS-6 plant and the ACP. You drive in there now and look, you'll see kind of a tent structure. So Wims put that up as a salt storage shed. Was an old one on site that was pretty decrepit, and folks came up with a good alternative, and we saw sewer shed on site. So again, kind of maintaining the site, making sure we maintain the appropriate investment in it, and good job to the folks that have done all that in a safe and compliant fashion. Land transfer and reindustrialization. So that thing is kicking off very well, irrespective of the characters in that picture. But as we've talked, there was a request for a small portion of the site down there. I guess about a little bit over 11 acres. What we've gone, as we talked about, is, hey, let's take as big a chunks as we reasonably can. And so right now, Greg, you want to talk about this?
Sure.
You're going after about just slightly less than a couple hundred acres, right? So I think for first it's what, 100?
Right at 100 acres.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, any comments?
No.
Okay. What, either one?
So we evaluated a little over 100 acres, 108 acres to be exact, for transfer. We talked about this. And there are some areas that we essentially want to avoid right now, namely about approximately 12 acres that are wells that were on site that were test wells, and they've not been abandoned yet. And so instead of saddling the future owner with wells that have to have a lot of money and effort put into abandoning them per procedure, we'll discard those out. We've got about 95 plus or minus acres that will be available for transfer, and that we evaluated. We talked before about the data collection to ensure that it is clean by standards for industrial reuse, and the data has been collected and analyzed, and we have an independent verification contract out of Oak Ridge, and they came up and did their data collection and have verified, and we expect the results of that verification sometime later this month, and that will make sure that we didn't miss something and that our procedures and our plans for going out and collecting the data were adequate for that. The land is known as the airstrip. It's pretty flat and it's inside a perimeter road. It has formerly had a building on it that was an office building, so you have some limited infrastructure at the edge of the property, so it conceivably would be ready for development relatively quickly, especially if it wasn't a large sewer or water user. And I believe SSAB's reworking their request to expand somewhat, and that would be available, we believe, for lease still this spring. So we have a schedule, we have all the pieces that are moving. We'll be doing notifications to the state. Michael, we talked about this a little bit before, but the EPA and the Department of Health, I'm sure, would want to see some of these reports. But essentially, we believed it to be clean. We're doing the verification to make sure that it is. Ultimately, the governor will say, you know, we agree that it's safe or we don't, or maybe you need to do more work. And so, you know, the governor's office will be doing the review. I'm guessing they'll hand it off to one of the departments within the state. We anticipate all this taking, you know, still a couple months for the work to do a lease. An actual deed transfer, we're penciled in for the first quarter of next calendar year. So the lease is not as intrusive and doesn't have all the notifications and things. A lease is much more limited because the department still retains ownership. When we actually transfer ownership, you're also transferring basically into control of the state. So that takes more time, a lot more notifications, and also involves congressional notification. So it's several months of each one of those. But we believe we can get the lease done this spring. I keep reminding Joel, spring doesn't end until June 21st. He keeps saying March.
March
Ron, do you have something?
What all utilities will be supplied to that?
Well, we have water and sewer that are at the edge on the bottom part, right? And there's also the natural gas line that was put into the site, runs across the middle of the airfield. And then there's electricity also right there by the old building site. So there's electricity all over. So they'd be all available. We still have work to do on that, quite frankly. We have an agreement with Pike County to do the sewer, to serve, you know, for sewer treatment. I would imagine that could be expanded. We have to do another agreement for water, electric, may or may not involve AEP or us. And so we've still got some of those administrative issues.
The water would feed off of?
Our system.
Okay. And was all of that system put in the 1950s, and was much of it or any of it replaced since that time?
Yeah, so, and folks that know, correct me if I'm wrong. So remember we talked about the GDP, and so it's really kind of two different construction bases, right? So you had the GDP, which is the first one, right?
Okay.
And then down here you had the centrifuge project, which was the second. So the utilities kind of rolled that way too. So GDP, yes, they're the 50s finished stuff. ACP, now you're talking 70s.
The building that had service was put in the late 70s with the centrifuge project.
Yeah, let's just slide down on this end, it's kind of centrifuge related. But you know, there is some, you know, some interweaving and stuff, so.
But
I was just wondering about the conditions of some of the lines.
Yeah, so, I mean, you just, even the 70s finished stuff, you still have to maintain it, you know what I mean? So, and that's what I try to, you know, the fire hydrant stuff, so we're working fire hydrants in all areas. So we, it's not just that we're fixing the old GDP hydrants, we're also replacing some other VACP spaces.
Are there plans to replace the fire tower that on the GDP side?
Yeah, so we're looking at repairing or doing something.
Repair and replace.
Yeah, yeah. So Carl's bringing that up because over this winter, there's a leak at the bottom of that thing. And, I mean.
We had two leaks.
Well, yeah, two leaks, and it was pretty, postcard, because it started spraying, you know, about 200 gallons a minute, and it was about, what, 11 degrees outside or something like that.
Pretty inside that.
So you can imagine, it looked like a winter wonder cycle, so. So, but anyway, so, you know, a lot of you folks have been on the board for a while, we've been talking about this for quite some time. Hey, it's happening, it's gonna happen here in our lifetime.
You made reference to the 12 wells, that you were gonna go ahead and just kind of work around those. Can you just kind of point out the general area of the location of those wells?
This area right here.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay.
And just basically, they were horizontal and vertical, they were checking water movement, water, how fast water moved up and down. It was just, it was testing wells, just to get an idea. And it's not just a bunch of vertical wells, but some of the horizontal too. So it's a little more involved to abandon them properly. And it's not a cheap venture, and they didn't want to saddle that, and it's our responsibility, you know, so we'll have to abandon those ultimately.
And those were put there to?
They were actually put there, if Greg can come on, but I believe once we're talking over there, if you drove into the site and looked over to the Snake Woods, there's actually a demonstration test there for particular, you know, groundwater, you know, soil, groundwater contamination, you know, treatment. And that included, you know, different well, and it was a long time ago, so. But it wasn't to actually treat anything, it was just to demonstrate the technology.
Okay, all right.
And as Greg mentioned, so essentially you got a bunch of that equipment over there that we've been, that's kind of abandoned in place, and, you know, to make things quick, we just said, cut it out, we'll deal with that, and don't settle the property transfer schedule and that stuff.
Okay.
Is that correct, Greg?
Yep.
Okay, and this thing down there, in case you're wondering, what that is.
This one.
That is not a deer feeder. That's actually a sensitive radiation surveyor, basically. So.
Yeah, we did three levels of data collection, essentially. We drove, and we had a picture of it before, I think it was a subcommittee, but we drove a piece of equipment over, and statistically, it was about a 20% sample, I think, and they drove it over and collected data. And then areas that had, and all that was below the levels for industrial reuse, but the areas that had the highest readings, we took the 40 highest and went in with that equipment and did more further analysis, and then we took the 10 highest readings that we had there and actually did physical samples. So it's statistically, that's a planning to follow. If, you know, on an industrial site like this, none of the readings were above industrial levels. And you know, so we have a bunch of data and things we're preparing to start compiling into a report. We have a draft of that report, so once that becomes final, then we'll start working with the state on their, you know, their review of it too.
Okay. So the next one is, you know, again, this one is one of those things that doesn't change much, but we want to make sure we kind of touch it every, you know, as part of our update. So, you know, one of the things that we are continuing to do is do the groundwater remedies, continue our pump and treat operations in place. Again, you don't see a lot of productivity there, but, you know, over time we do see, you know, plumes are actually, you know, see some dissipation. They are active. Folks do a good job operating these things in a compliant fashion. But as we mentioned before, you know, the this rate, it takes a long time, which is our justification for you know, the best opportunity, you know, was to get the soil out and put it over as part of our disposal strategy. So we kind of see, you know, how productive each section is, and no offense there, folks do a good job continuing to operate that stuff. Next,
Joe.
Yeah.
What's that? Now, on the right-hand column is the indication of how many.
So pounds removed.
In 2016, what left that area? So evidently, the 623 is the least contaminated.
No, what that's saying is
that what it means?
Well, so you gotta look at this. So 623 is kind of an intermittent use. And so this is how much groundwater it pulled out and treated.
Yeah.
Okay, or how much groundwater got to, or yeah, got delivered. And so you can see the 624, you got, you know, over 300,000 gallons.
Of water.
Okay, so a lot of water, reasonably speaking, and
just shy of 10 pounds of TC.
Does one area seem to be a little higher assay than the other area?
I mean, so if you remember a groundwater plume map, it has some different colors on it. That gives you how much the concentration of the contaminant is in that plume. And 701B is typically, you know, the most contaminated. But, you know, we talked about that because of, the geology is so tight, it's hard to pump the stuff out, because you just like sipping water out of, you know, your straw in a McDonald's cup, and you're at the very bottom, and you take a bit, and then, you know, you gurgles, and you got to wait for it to fill back up again before you can take another sip out. Kind of what you see going. So it recharge very quick.
So there's nothing surprising with that.
No, it's not.
It's very understandable.
It's very understandable. What that tells you is based on the plume, and this one's a 701B, is, you know, kind of right over here, is, and this is part of this, you know, business case that we're going, that'll take a very long time.
Yeah.
Trichlor ethylene is about 7-6 pounds per gallon, so out of 300 and some thousand gallons pulled off, you've got less than 2 gallons of TCE that came out of that, so it takes forever.
Are you noticing any reduction since we're not really doing anything there?
And we do see a reduction, but it's just, that's not much of a reduction.
Yeah, okay. Now this groundwater, is that, that's not rainwater, that's pulled out of the ground.
There's some of that, yeah. So you got, you know, surface water, and then you'll have that, you know, surface water will migrate into your groundwater, and then some, you know, will flow off into the little Beaver Creek that goes around there. So yes, this does recharge, and if you had the profile of it, you can kind of follow it with, you know, big rain events and that kind of stuff.
But see, Maria, when she was here, she said, we don't know what's under those buildings.
Well, and so
water is a little bit.
So actually, so we talk about the deferred unit piece of it. So that is actually what they're doing out there as part of their deferred unit sampling. Okay, and so if you remember, we call it deferred units because back when they set this stuff up, you know, I'll say U6 still had the plant and these things were still operating. And so we go, you know what, we got to sample that under there, but the buildings are still in operation. So we're going to defer those for a while. It's the tag name, deferred units. So now that they're shut down, there's a team going out there, and maybe we can have an update on that, you know, one of the subcommittee meetings or something. But they're going through and doing now this deferred unit sample. And so that's, they're actually going and checking what's under the building. So, but that said, you know, with the last bits, and if you flip back, well, we'll talk about life cycle baseline. So part of the demolition activity is really the above-grade structure. There's another piece where we come back and take out all the foundations and everything else. So you'll get to it clean and dirty. You're going to take out the man-made stuff that's there, upgrade, just like
before. I also wanted to add, especially for the people from Ross County, I know this discussion with you years ago with somebody from the EPA that was here. And he was a scientist that had examined all the plumes in several county areas down here, and the worst one is actually under wherever. It's not the site. So that's just something to think about in our community. When you learn how to do things here, you know, just to remember we've got that site wherever that has sit there for years and that's where some of our worst water contamination is coming from.
So, anyway, but I just, I don't want us to forget that we are doing active groundwater remediation out there now, although it's, you know, nothing happens fast. I just want to keep that on the screen there for you folks. Okay, any other questions on that? I'll get them. Okay. The DUF6 project, so it's been down for a while, and you can just kind of see. You know, they had the event, if you remember back, you know, months ago, they had the, you know, the operators had got, you know, some chemicals on them. So they, the operator, or in this case, UWSD, has stood the plant down and been going through some, you know, the self-internal look and going through some restart preparations, including procedure readings and that kind of stuff. So, not a lot to talk about since the last time, just the DUF6 project. Site tours since last time. So we had Congressman Winster's staff came in for a tour. The congressman wasn't a part of it. It was the staff they were looking for. I guess they go around and have, you know, meet a different representative, regional rep, you know, facilities, and just have them discussion so everybody knows what's going on. So we're happy to host them. And we had the U.S. Army Reserves come in. Again, they kind of do the same thing. They go around to the different areas as a kind of training exercise, an informational exercise. So they came through not too long ago. And we had a quick site visit from our new EM1, Dr. Greg Robuto. She wanted to make sure she visited the site. She also wanted to make sure that her regards to everybody who was impressed that she wasn't able to visit. She didn't meet with any of the local elected officials either. She was just she had a short window, quick stop here, and then she went to Paducah from our place and back to D.C. She came in. Most of the people she was interested in talking to were the workers. She didn't even meet with our staff. So if you want to see the place, get understanding, help the folks do the job, and go. So, but she was excited, interested in it. One thing I will mention also is, so she's interested in technology. So one of the things she did bring up is, you know, our plans are to segment the big converters in 333. And so she thought that would be a great opportunity for maybe some technology deployment to assist us. And so she's a big proponent of that. And so as soon as she got back to her place, she asked somebody to come down and start helping us with some, you know, looking at available technologies to, you know, facilitate segmentation of the components that we got out there. So I'd say good support. And it was a good visit, although it was short. What else we got? Yeah, so mutual aid, I think that's an important interaction with between the site and local community. And so this just gives, let me back on that just a tab, it just gives, kind of account of mutual aid responses. Again, the folks who do that are local fire department folks, EMTs. Great job, great folks. Three vehicle accidents, two fires, some other stuff, and they are actively engaged. The other thing is there was a monthly meeting with Pike County Firefighters Association, and so that's another, you know, benefit to kind of integration with the city community, or probably more the other way, community's integrated with fire department there. And so they routinely host, you know, the local fire departments around the site, and so I think that's very positive with those folks too. Next slide. So there was awards made to folks on site with 40 or more years of service. And although I don't know the names of most of the folks up there, I do recognize a few.
You're 15 when you started, right, Carl?
That's right. So, and as a, you know, congratulations to everybody and Carl's a great guy. So, let's see, what else we got? Community outreach? Just a lot of people volunteer at times, it's awesome. So what you see is some of the community outreach up there, $3,400 for breast cancer research, $1,000 for a book cart for the Jasper Elementary School, and let's see what else. So I got Mark Hill, who's done a presentation in here, also provided one to kind of listen to this thing. Portsmouth West. Got the Gineso, and been hearing about some of that stuff. Receives an international award, so we talk about it, and it's not something that we all see every day, and I'll say myself included, but there are a lot of people out there pulling for, you know, opportunities for, you know, not just the county, Fort County area, but also, you know, for the site as well. So I think that's a really positive thing. And that's supported also by the Community Commitment Fund that SSAB has. Let's see, what else you got there? Oh, you got, touch everything else? Well, another one was Gunner Protege, and then there's some small business stuff there. And let's see, one of the anchors, local anchors. Upcoming site events, so some of you participating, Science School's coming up next week, as always a fantastic event. There's an SSAB field trip on Saturday, March the 12th, the day after that, which several, a bunch of you are going on. Next full board meeting is the 5th of May, and last but not least, we are planning a controlled prairie burn on the old sludge. And if you know, if you call driving through Fog Road down there and you see that, you know, that prairie will be placed there on the far side. So we periodically, every 3 to 5 years, burn that to keep the, you know, the rooty trees and stuff from growing on that. That one's coming up. I give you the exact date. But it's very weather dependent, and so what people will do, the folks that are in charge of that will watch and look at the weather forecast and coordinate that with the local community officials, and you know, the weather is exactly right that we can burn. And the whole goal there is to only burn what you want to burn, right? That's what I know. So that's it. Questions?
Tell you what, Jeff, since the slide's up, what if we go ahead and let you do the sales pitch on the Fernald trip?
Sure.
You guys all know Jeff Wagner?
He was back, was it November at the subcommittee meetings? You had suggested that we get a field trip together, pick a date, head out to Fernald so we can get a chance to see what the Fernald Preserve looks like, get a chance to walk up on the disposal cell there and get a feel for you know, what an operating cell looks like and how it fits into the community. So we picked the date, March 12th, the Saturday. We're going to be here bright and early at 7 o'clock, right out front.
A.M. or P.M.?
That would be A.M., Greg. So oh, you might want to just that. Drive right from Science Bowl. So 7 o'clock. I know it's an early start, but I tried to get it such that we wrap up and get you back at a reasonable time, because we know we've got a lot of things going on Saturdays. So we'll take the shuttle. It's about 2.5 hours to get to Fernald, so by 9:30 we'll get started. We've got 3 hours set aside there. Lisa Crawford, who was the head of Fresh, and some of her colleagues said they would come out too and join us for the tour. Coordinating this all with the DOE Office of Legacy Management, too. So we've got Joel and Dennis will help lead us. I've got so far, it's Bob, Carlton, Aldon, Martha, Stan, Carl, Will, and Judy who have signed up. But I've got some updated agendas here. If you want to pass those out, I can get some more. But the plan is spend 3 hours there, get the chance to walk all over. Like I said, wear sturdy shoes and some jeans. It'll either be snowing or it'll be 70, so we're not sure. Each weekend seems to change here. But looking forward to it. We think it'll be a good opportunity to see a site like that firsthand. Disposal cell, like I said, that's had time to mature. It was closed in late 2006, so you'll get a chance to see it now 10 years later.
And there's time to jump on the tour if you'd like.
Absolutely. There is time. Let me know, or Eric, or Julie or Cindy, and we'll get you signed up. And like I said, by 7 o'clock, we'll be heading out, and I'll bring the coffee and donuts. So have a little something to eat. You can sleep in the back of the bus. We'll have room to spread out.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Jeff, for having to let me get it. Are there any questions for Joel on his presentation? We covered a lot of ground. Okay. Hey, Joel mentioned at the beginning of his presentation the board winning the Pike County Chamber of Commerce Organization of the Year Award. We had the award, as well as the board received several commendations and letters of support after winning the award, and they're all in the back. And that's really a tribute to what's been probably right at a decade's worth of work by several volunteers, probably close to 40 folks that have served on this board for some time or other. And it's the work that you guys have done and put in that have really helped get us to this point. And so this is something I'm really proud to say we're part of. I know that when we contacted the folks at headquarters and told them that the board had been recognized, they were just ecstatic, and it was a big deal, not just locally, but across the DOE complex. So you guys are pretty committed to that. That's very impressive. Okay. Greg, you have comments as for the board here?
I have a few.
Go ahead, sir.
I wanted to just fill in a couple of details on the science bowl. I believe we have been having training sessions from the different jobs that we have, timekeeper, moderator. We have training every year for that. So, Jack, have we had the training for the advisory board members yet?
Yes, we just had it this evening.
Okay.
Had a number of folks come through that, and they're ready to go. So, that's quite a nice
group
of volunteers this year.
39 teams?
38 teams.
38 teams. That's right, we have one reduction.
Yes.
38 teams, which is more than we've ever had. And most all the high schools in the four counties are represented, including CPC here locally, and we're excited about that. Be a little bit different format because we're trying to accommodate so many teams. Ideally, it'd be 32, as surely nobody here does, but that's on the NCAA tournament, 64, 32, and on down. You want multiples like that. 38 is a little more difficult, so we'll have a little different format, but all the teams will be able to play several matches, and I've seen a lot of the regionals that send teams home. Sometimes they drive hours to get there because they're usually regional. We're very fortunate that we don't have to drive clear to Cincinnati for hours anymore. And they'll play two matches and turn around an hour later and go home. In our case, they stay for hours and get to play multiple matches, a minimum of four. And we have great facility at Shawnee State, and it's always a good thing when you have kids on a college campus. It doesn't hurt to get them there and let them see and have a good time, and wonderful facilities, and it's a great day. So I'm glad we had so many volunteers from the board. The second thing that I wanted to just talk briefly about, next week's committee meetings, and Joel's going to talk about the budget, but we have guidance that we've been given. This is the second year, and it's getting more specific on our interaction with the board on the budget. And I think it's a good thing because it's allowing the community, like this board, to have input into the budget development process. We'll go into a lot more details at our budget subcommittee meeting next Tuesday evening. But just to keep in mind, you've had some, I think, fundamental
ideas that you've carried throughout the entire existence of this board. Personal property transfer, getting some value for that, relates to waste stream reduction, minimizes what gets disposed of, creates value out of something that would cost money to dispose of. That's something that's been carried throughout. I looked at the recommendation last week, what you guys gave us for this budget year, and when you look at the president's request, it really hits it. And so we'd like to see some thought come into it. We'll get into specifics, but I would think a budget recommendation September at the latest would still allow for that to be included in our site request, and that I think is helpful when the site requests money, and you have like our board's recommendation goes up with that request. You've also had been very supportive of footprint reduction, which is another way of saying cleanup complete, which is a good thing. So I just challenge us to start thinking about some of the things you want in a recommendation, not just specific numbers, but DOE, we'd like to see this much reduction by this date, or DOE, do this with property, personal property transfer. It creates value, creates actually money that can be invested in economic development projects. That's important. And so beyond just the normal thing, we want this much money. The other thing that Joel will probably talk about, but that I think we need to get into this year, is the volatility of the uranium market. Planning a project like this is difficult, and keeping it on track and having it on budget is virtually impossible for any site. But our site has so much dependency on a volatile commodity that gets traded that if it changes by 5 or 10% can literally mean the difference between what we plan on getting done or not. And so I think we also need to think of ways that we could have input from the community side saying, you've got to recognize that, department, and figure out a way that we can reduce some of the volatility of our budget. We plan this project about every month, it seems like, to go through exercises. It's difficult. So it's difficult for every site, but our site's even more so. So I think the board should think about things like real personal property. I think we should think about kind of broad objectives like that, because I believe it carries weight. So we'll get into that more next week. Beyond that, Eric, I don't have anything.
Perfect. Any questions for Greg? Thank you, sir. Mike?
Well, I know we want to get out of here by 8.
Take all the time you want, sir.
Yeah. I know I talk a lot usually, so we keep it to a minimum. we have been, Department of Health and Iowa EPA have been reviewing the process building and immediately designed veto action work plan, ODH, anyway, we don't have any major issues. It was just like you're meeting what you committed to do. So I think I had an email today saying that we need to have those comments due by March 11th. So that's basically what we've been working on.
Yeah. Any questions for Mike? All right, so the meat of tonight's meeting is the budget presentation, and that is actually pieces of it under several parts of your binder. I think you're going to find it under tabs 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, because they're all kind of different presentations, so it's easier to follow the segment. So with that, get back on, sir.
Can everybody read that?
Hey, so in general, the president's budget, we talked a little bit about that, and if you've read what came out, so I think we talked about 16 a little bit, so the 16 number got enacted, was a good number, and we are about a $400 million, site budget. So as long as we're in that range, we do a pretty good job. For the 17 budget the president's proposed, remember back, as Greg mentioned, we'll get into it in the subcommittee stuff. But the process is mandated by law. So the president proposes a budget, Congress weighs in on that. And so that process will be starting but in general, you know, the president's request actually was a good one. We got, and as Greg mentioned, remember, we got appropriated dollars, and then we also supplement or augment the remainder with ordered funds, okay? So from an appropriation standpoint, $231 million for the, I'll say, the operating piece, and about $40 million and some change for the line item capital piece that we proposed. So going into the year, into 17, we had planned on barter being about $150 million, which would take us up to about 431 or thereabouts, okay? As Greg mentioned, you know, we were all happy with that. In 15, you know, the barter value actually that we realized is about $180 million. So in 16, we're going into it, our first quarter sales were good, and so if you watch the market, which almost everybody else like does nowadays, it's actually started turning down. So if it stays at the value of the last, and we adjusted that down a little bit more in our forecast, we could see about an $8 million impact from the barter stuff. Okay, so we think we can probably handle that in 16, but we also carry that in 17, and there's a potential for another, you know, depending on the price, another, you know, $10 to $15 million impact in 17. So we could have, you could see a cumulative impact of maybe around $30 million in 17. So good news is that's early on, or we recognize this early on, and so we could put some things into play to kind of compensate for that. The other piece that we talk about that I don't know, is kind of maybe a little difficult to kind of imagine, is we talk about carry-in. So the money that we didn't spend in 15, right, we carry into FY16. And that has been, overall, probably about $30 million. We do have a target every year. I mean, we try to hit our funding profile. We try to carry in enough money, enough carry in at a minimum to cover about a month, 3 weeks, of funding for all the contractors on site and all the, you know, the other utilities and the DOE directs. And so that's typically about $35 million. Okay, so fortunately we have some additional carryover going into 16, and we'll be working with Floor to, you know, actually execute some barter, looks forward into, you know, future prices and that kind of stuff to see what we can do to maybe, you know, hedge our bets going into 17 so we don't put ourselves in a bind. But obviously, you know, we don't want $30 million to be an impact to us. Don't know what that is right now. Otherwise, we probably all be in a different job in the commodities market. But that's the current forecast of 17. Again, good news is that this time, based on all the support and discussions from new folks and elected officials, the appropriations is up, and 17 requests is up. So that's good. Now, so how does that work with life cycle baseline? All right, so we've had some presentations on this, primarily in the subcommittees. Okay, so, you know, what's the work on site? And you saw that in the schedule up front, and this is just another kind of depiction of what that work is: decommissioning, environmental remediation. We obviously still have site operations. We have waste disposal. This one's on-site disposal, but we also have off-site disposal that was part of the plan. And then you can see that then there's some rendition footprint in there. So waste management, off-site disposal, and then of course we still have, you know, nuclear material that we have to manage. So all the stuff, you go, hey, here's all the chunks of work, kind of a little bit more granular than what you saw in that big picture. And so what we do is try to kind of, you know, look at how much work that is, and then put a dollar value to that, and then integrate those, you know, spread, and, you know, over time. Okay, so that's really about how we establish this life cycle baseline. And this is from where we are today. I'll say back at where we were in 2014 is when we got the file this thing all the way to completion, which is certified the areas have met the remediation goals, you know, property, you know, disposition to the extent we can, and then some period of time where this cycle transition over to what we call legacy management, which I think we talked about, and the Fernald visit will be that's under the legacy management. Chapter So typically then, what you do is you know, you have those activities, those scopes of work is what we're called, and then you put those into some organization, and for, you know, folks that do project work, you typically refer to those, you know, as, you put those in an organization called a work breakdown structure. And so that just then kind of gives you even further, I guess, the definitization of what that work is. And so if you roll it up a little bit more, there you go. So you can see under waste management, you can see all the little discrete pieces of work under waste management as an example. You know, D&D, on-site disposal, uranium disposition, and then other stuff, okay? Facility D&D, you can break that down, process buildings, balance the plant, and then there's also some care and maintenance that goes into that as well. Environmental remediation, soil, groundwater, excess nuclear material. So if you can kind of see, if you can kind of get the sense of how this baseline is kind of composed, I'll say. And then there's the other site infrastructure and support. So we also take into account all the little things that we have to do to maintain the site from a programmatic standpoint. And we assign those to, you know, prime contractors. So you see down there, there's been a lot of work going, hey, is it DOE stuff, DOE direct. So what that means is DOE gets to go for that straight. So State of Ohio grant, we fund that work. OVEC power off the site, DOE gets the electric bill, and then we allocate that to the tenants on site. That's kind of how that's set up. We're just cracking through this thing. We're going to the next chapter. If you guys have questions, just jump right into it. Okay, but I'm just trying to, this is how this thing's compiled. And so if you get the sense out of this, there's another one, tough to read. But if you get the sense out of this, so when we have, you know, perturbations in funding or targets or something like that, then you can actually move this stuff, you know, kind of like in concert, if you can understand what I mean. So some of the stuff, you got to pay for it. Okay, again, we're no different than I'll say anybody else. We can't not pay the electric bill, as an example, okay? There's some things we have to do, all right? And then there's, and so we typically refer to that as you know, our site, I'll say site landlord activities, our site S&M. You know, that is almost a non-negotiable thing we got to do. Regulatory compliance falls into that. We can't go out there and click off the monitoring tree. We have a commitment to do that. All right, so with that said, then now you get into, okay, after we move forward, and what's the basic construct of the work? And so then what the folks do is break that down and then kind of put that thing in some logical order, okay? And so you can see what's happened here is you know, the depiction of the site, and then with that depiction of the site, coming up with some strategic strategy on how to, you know, best and most efficiently go through the site and clean it up. And you guys have this in your hand. There won't be a test on this. You can read it at your leisure. And then that's, you know, subcommittee meetings. And then we'll go over, the intent is to also continue to kind of standard this stuff. And so you can ask questions, you know, whatever in the future, you know, whenever the thing strikes you. But So with this, you know, this is kind of depicts the grand scheme, and you can see the arrow right there. That's kind of, you know, if you talk to the floor folks, they'll call it a swoosh. Okay, it says, hey, you know, it makes sense to kind of move from one side of the site to the other. And if you think about it, you got to be careful. You know, it's not a simple task. We talked about the utilities out there. You know, those were not made to stop working, okay? Those were made to, you know, the plant was made to run, okay? And it was made to run well, and made to run almost no matter what happened to it, okay? Which means you could cross-connect stuff, you could keep things operable, you could lose a little piece, and still work around it and do your job, okay? So that makes it really difficult to kind of go through cleanup in a safe fashion, okay? So a lot of care and thought goes into that. And then the other piece is, you know, you got to consider, you know, the hazardous constituents, and just like the medical profession, you know, do no harm.
right? So the goal of this thing is to clean the place up, make it safe. You don't want to make it worse, right? So all this stuff gets baked into the food. I'll flip to the next chapter. Final call. In your handbook, this is our, what we call our life cycle. And the time is critical past schedule, but this essentially is what I'd say is our graphical depiction of our life cycle baseline. All right, and so this is based on a funding profile also, all right? And so this happens to be made on a funding profile, I'll say, of about $318 million for the demolition type work. Because there are other things we could come in, like do security is a piece of that. So as you plan this stuff, you need to know kind of a funding target for you. And so this particular plan was made at about the $318 million level. So if you, again, it's hard to see on here, but if you could look at it closely, maybe zoom in on one little piece. Actually, if you zoom in, so you can see how this is broken down. Remember the first slide in the DFO presentation, which said, you know, D&D, and it showed the big chunks of the buildings up there. So this is a little bit more granular, okay? So this one's broken down. You can see it by actually activities for each process building. So there were the little days corner. So here is the 326. So you can see cut and cap converters, okay? Remember the slide we pitched up there, status of cut and cap? All right, that's that activity's plan right there. And you can see it was planned to wrap up here in FY16. And the folks are reasonably on track on that, okay? That may finish up a little bit farther than that, but, you know, this thing was constructed in 2014, you know, and we're doing the toughest building first. You know, the folks are doing a pretty good job, okay? Here you talk about auxiliary systems, so that's a little bit, you know, that's other stuff in the building. And then you get down to this thing called cold and dark, which hits there, somewhere about, you know, the FY17 plan. I can tell you right now, we're looking at that probably slid, all things considered because of these other things, probably into, you know, probably the third quarter of FY17. But again, on the grand scale thing, you know, we're tracking reasonably well to that. But this is how we're progressing the systems down. So if I go, hey, here's where we are today, I'm cutting cap, you go, pull up your sheet here, go, okay, so how come you're falling behind on this stuff? Or, you know what, you guys are doing pretty well, you're ahead of schedule. All right, so that's what the benefit of this is. And you can kind of see where we go to next. Okay, you wrap this up and you go to the next thing. Excuse me. So the other thing you can see is the progression would be to the folks that are working hard in 326, once we get to this place, cold and dark, which essentially is it's ready to demolish. Okay? Then those folks would roll down to 333 and start doing the same thing in 333. Okay, a little bit different building. Maybe a different approach, but essentially it's just, you gotta do the same stuff.
Would this be something we wanna look at incorporating over the next few months into the recommendation on budget?
Yeah. So that's great, brings up a very good point, okay? So when you guys, and more specific, you can be in a recommendation like that and you know, for the next budget cycle, you know, if this makes sense to you, going, hey, you know what? We want you to give enough money, and you might say enough money to get, not only do this, but do a little bit more. Okay, so that's how all this stuff can come and, you know, finally get together to be a little bit more understandable. And we can status this stuff, you know, as part of our normal discourse in board meetings and subcommittee meetings. So, but you can kind of see the thought is 326, 333, down to 330. Okay. The other thing you'll see up here is some demolition milestones. And if you roll down, you'll see that that's tied into having enough capacity having the on-site disposal stuff complete enough that you've got enough capacity to dispose of all the debris that demolition that building's going to generate. So you can kind of imagine that there's a logical tie between the work there at the site, okay? And as the funding moves around a little bit, things move, accelerate, or things slow down. Also, we typically look at revisiting this thing on an annual basis, because these assumptions were made, you know, based on best information available. In this case, it started coming in 2013. So you always learn something more the farther down you go. And so, and I'll say as an example, somewhere up in 330, we talk about segmentation. I'm sorry, 333. Segmentation. I don't know what that is, but it's not here.
Ah, okay.
Can you drop down and really raise the screen? Here we go. So segmentation, okay? So at the time there, we weren't really sure where and how we were going to do that, just that we were going to segment. That was the plan, okay? The current thought now is, you know what? It might make more sense to have that, you know, up inside the 333 building. These are great big pieces of equipment, if you've never seen them, and the less you got to pick those suckers up and move them, the better off you are. So the thought now may be is, hey, let's look at keeping that stuff up and close together, rather than having that take it down, drop it out, and move it somewhere else. So all that stuff is still, you know, kind of a work in progress. You know, Floor's got some sharp people focusing on that. And also this technology development comes into play as well. So, and when you finally say, hey, this is how we're going to do that, this would then be kind of updated to reflect your current approach, if that makes sense to you. And so if you follow it down, so this remediation piece talks about, Aldon mentioned, hey, what's underneath the buildings out there? You can see that we've also got slab removal and then certification of areas as we go through the process. And then down, keep scrolling down a little bit. Now this ties into the operation, the construction and operation of the on-site disposal cell. And so hear us talking, or Johnny talking about, or JD talking about, you know, what we're doing. We just started. Let's see, I forget what that is. Okay, so cell liner one started that, and so, you know, part of that start was, you know, need to clear the trees out. And then you can follow that down along, and you can see if you went first waste placement and you tied that up there, you know, so this would be tied down to, and you can see when we start going and gathering fill. Plumes and landfills, you know, detailed out down below this stuff. So if you remember up in the first slide, and we talked about it before, you know, we've got a plan. Each area, including the landfill, is tied to a specific building, and then so you can integrate that into all these activities, make sure that you have the proper utility isolations in place before you do that, you know, plan your excavations and all the civil work that goes into, you know, doing some major, you know, soil excavation. So anyway, that's how it all lines out. And so when we look at impacts from funding, obviously, you know, jobs are the first thing that come to your head. And then those, you know, the impact of that then actually impacts these activities that you see up there on the plan. So that's how we can relate not only an impact to folks at the site, but also to progress on the project. The other thing you can see up there is there's really nothing rocket science up there. I'll say we don't have something up there that we got to go figure out how to design the next anti-gravity device or something like that, which really comes a lot of uncertainty in the schedule and that stuff. This is just it's some money, it's not far we can get. So this is a pretty beneficial, and we use this on a fairly frequent basis. This thing gets broken down much more detailed than this, and then also there's, you know, my contract period performance. So each contractor goes, hey, this is in my wheelhouse, that, this work is then turned into contract, you know, work scope, which I guess is put into, you know, respective contractors' contract. Performance is by.
Can you also touch on executive subcommittee meeting? Dennis discussed the fact that because of the way they have to structure the budget, that they have to take away from onsite disposal, so why it's important that our politicians, everyone understand how we need, that it's only allocated so much, how we need to build that back.
Yeah, so, yes. So Christy brings up a big point. So a lot of the times, you'll see, you know, the site is looked at kind of holistically. Okay, and if you might imagine, you know, if you're up in headquarters in EM and you have to plan budget planning for, you know, all the sites they have, you know, the complex, you know, you're looking at the site in a summary level. And so when I mention, hey, we're about a $400 million site, you know, what they say then is go, okay, here's how things are going to be jigged around underneath that to some total, whatever they can afford it, you know, in a given fiscal year. And so what's important, what Christy's kind of getting at is, you know, this is a symphony, okay? And so each of these are instrumentals and you need to play them, they need to all play in concert, okay? And so if you don't fund something down here, then at some point up here, you can't go any farther. And so, yeah, you could work up here, for example, you could continue to deactivate buildings, but at some point in time, we need to start tearing buildings down, right? Because there's not much left to deactivate. And of course, that's out in the future sometime, but at some point, you know, that stops the work at the site. And so you need to make sure that all these things kind of work as best you can in tandem. And so that's what this budget, you know, and bucketing process might support. You can't do one and sacrifice another without, you know, sometime having to pay the piper on this thing. Does that answer your question?
That and the fact that RMJD can speak to this. I mean, guys, a couple of years ago, you were budgeted for like $34 million on onsite disposal, and that got cut to like $20 million, which meant that when the budget came up, because they couldn't increase something without doing something else, it will stay at $20 million. And so we can get that extra, you know, because I would have thought, well, okay, so we'll cut $20 million, let's just take away from beer and pay Paul. That's not the way it works.
So I think, Chris, now what you're getting at is you know, we call it the different colors of money, okay?
Yeah.
And so the all the cell work down here is what's in the line item capital category, okay? And that's specifically authorized, you know, by Congress. And you cannot mix money here, up here, or any of the columns up above. And so, conversely, I can't mix any money I get up here and construction area down here, the sell stuff down here, that is, you know, congressional reserve to Congress, now. And so that's the whole trick there. Whatever they give you, that's what you got.
And so we actually, as a community, have to get our politicians to support the fact that opening up that line of credit, makes sense, gets more money in there.
Yeah, so what Greg was saying too, and so this is, I think it's a really good thing. So when you guys consider what you want to say in your recommendations,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, this is what you need to understand. What we need to make sure that you understand is where we're at relative to progress, right? You know, and then you know, a lot of the stuff you go, hey, here's how, you know, you think work should be. Would recommend priorities.
And I think another reason why it's important in this, you know, several county communities, the on-site disposal cells are going to bring in a lot of tradespeople. And if you've listened over the years in our area, just to have the tradespeople be able to work in our community compared to going to Columbus or Cincinnati and everything. So there are a lot of tradespeople that are looking, you know, for future jobs, local jobs.
So this, I'd say this is a pretty important
piece of work here, and it'll take a while to get the hang of it. And then, but once you do, I mean, it's really the decoder ring for what we're doing. If you get to the end of, when you're looking at it, you can slide this way a little bit. So here's the other thing that you might go, what's this? Right? And so at the end of the day, this is our best, this is our educated guess, okay? And so when you see things in here like, you know, a P50, you go, okay, what is that P50? So what, if you get, to the folks that have specialized in putting these things together. What you do is when you plan this, when I mentioned it was a 318 number, this is planned against, and when I say 318, I exclude, you know, the security stuff, you know, all the other little, you know, things that, then roll up to this 400 number thereabouts. We say that's kind of the deterministic. And so that says, hey, you know, if everything goes exactly as planned, we'll get it done by then. Of course, we all know life does not work like that. Nor does it work in project land like that, too. And so then we start baking in, hey, we got some risk and uncertainty with these things. You know what I mean? What if I forgot something? What if I get into this and find something different? What that then rolls you down to is this thing called a P50. And P50 is go, hey, you know, I've got a 50-50 chance, you know, of nailing it there. So if I flip the coin 10 times, you know what? 5 times it's going to hit there. The other 5 times it's going to hit somewhere else. The 5 times it's going to come in about there. We also have something called P80, okay, which says, hey, you know, with this amount of funding and this and taking into consideration all this other stuff, when I flip that coin 10 times, 8 times it's going to go right there. Okay, so all that's just, and at the end of the day, you know, it is still a educated guess. But that's kind of what that stuff means. And so, you know, there's some discussion back about, you know, P50, P80, which is deterministic. You know, the fact is even though there's a lot of difference right there, the fact is that, you know, there's, you know, we feel pretty good that we know the work that we got into. Okay? And so, sure, there's something that you're always going to run into, you get planned. So, you know, some. In this time frame, you know, we feel pretty comfortable with that. As I mentioned, I gave you the status back on 326, cut and cap, and we were hoping to get that done by the end of, or cold yard by the end of 16, stretching it into a level 17. That's kind of what this other stuff reflects, things you didn't get done. Okay. And so when you add all that stuff up, you know, it gets you a little bit farther out than what you hope for. But there are going to be things that come up. Go, hey, look, this is easier than I thought, and it comes back the other way. So that's all that does. I'd say the most important thing to get your head around is how all these tasks are integrated, and then, you know, as part of, you know, deliberation, thought, and recommendation, and prioritization, that's what you want to talk about. Because again, if you go to, you know, the people in office right now, and you go, hey, you know what? We really want to go after the X, whatever that is, up there out in 2000 and wherever. They're going to go, great, I like that. I won't be around. You know what I mean? So the other thing to do is focus on the near term where it makes a difference and where they can feel the pleasure or the, you know, be part of the success or whatnot. So that would be the other thing to think about as you guys are going through this stuff. What impact can I make now?
And Joe, I think I have a question.
Yes, part of
that.
Yes, sir. Are we on schedule for the completion of the cut and cap on the converters and the compressors? I see on this chart it shows at the beginning of 16 it's supposed to be complete.
Yep. So, and that's what I mentioned before. So we are a little behind on that.
We're a little behind.
Yeah, we are a little
behind. Now, all that pertains to is the converters and compressors, not basically the lines that's in there. So mm-hmm. It'll still go on.
So in 326, so all right, so let's walk through this stuff. So if you go back on this thing.
It's over on the left side.
And all the way back to the There it is. There you go. So cut and cap converters and compressors. That's essentially process gas, you know, component removal. And, you know, so in the first part of the presentation, I said, hey, you know, you saw a picture of the component removal, and I talked about 326. So that's what that activity is.
Yep.
And so, yeah, we're hoping to have that. If you go up a little bit farther, so I see the date on that.
There it is.
There you go. So if you go up a little bit farther, you can see, as Aldon mentioned, you know, I'll say that's really the first quarter of FY16. Okay? So we're a little behind on that. So we're probably rolling into, you know, maybe the third quarter of FY16. But again, a couple months behind. Folks are working hard to wrap that stuff up. Is that going to be an impact to the whole thing? Well, so think about this. I'm really not ready for building demolition until 2019 in that. So is it going to impact the overall site? Well, maybe not. What we worry about is it taking away and precluding us from starting work down, you know, as planned next. But I think the folks, what you'll see as we talk through this stuff and as you get used to it, you know, they're starting auxiliary systems. And so the trick is wrapping up. The real kicker is this milestone called cold and dark. When are we done in that building? And that is right now by this plan, you know, at the start of 2017, again, which cold and dark right there. So in 17, that's probably slipped a couple months, but in general, we're tracking. Okay.
Now, I want 2017, that's supposed to start cutting and capping on the converters on it, aren't they?
Next building.
If the next schedule.
So in the next building, yeah? And,
yep.
And I think the folks are looking at that, and we're reasonably on track on that one. And the other thing that's important is that the plan was to roll these people out that are working in here and roll them down there. So not only is this budget-based, but it's also people-based. Right? And so you want to keep, you know, your people consistently employed, you know, because that just makes good sense.
Is it when they're cutting and capping, are they really taking it out, the pipes out clean too, and cutting cap those?
We'll have some presentations on that. So this is going to get into the, so now you'll get into waste acceptance criteria stuff. So remember in 326, you know, all the processed gas equipment goes out, and we've been shipping that to Nevada test site. Okay, so that's what this is talking about. There's going to be some components in there that don't meet transportation requirements just yet, but very few. And then those will be taken over to another building, and then they'll be, you know, addressed that way. You call it mechanically, you know, mine them, compressors, you pull the seals out, you know, coolers. But there's not that many of those. Those don't necessarily impact this because they will be pulled out of the building and taken to another facility to address. Okay.
Now, and when they're cutting and capping those converters and compressors, there's lines that goes. Are they doing that on the lines also?
So what they're doing
is it working pretty clean, or are they just cutting and capping it and then they have to go back?
Okay, so part of the stuff, and we've talked about that before, so this is a good conversation. All right, so this is where we get into, you know, what we call non-destructive assay. All right, where they take these radiation measurements of the pipe and the converters. That's how we know that there's some that we don't meet transportation requirements, and there's criteria that they have to meet in order for that pipe, valve, whatever the heck it is, there's a reading that it has to make or it comes out of the building. So it's less than criticality incredible, okay? As long as it's below that reading, it can stay in the building. If it's greater than that, it's got to come out. All right, and so that's what they're doing. So all these components, they're coming out and they're going regardless, right? Because they got a lot of inaccessible areas and that kind of stuff.
The converters and the compressors are shipped off-site, aren't they?
Absolutely.
How about the pipe they cut?
So that's what I'm saying. So what they do is they take measurements on all the pipe that's left and visual inspections on it. Okay, and then when it meets certain criteria, and that'll be the same for all these buildings down here, and actually all the balance of plants facilities, that is the standard approach to do it. So you go, you know, I'm gonna measure this stuff, and also, you know, we gotta make sure that hazardous, you know, materials are pulled out, so that's part of the process too. And all the things that don't
meet the waste acceptance criteria have to get out of the building. So first of all, it's make sure that it's safe from a nuclear standpoint, and then it's acceptable to dispose of on site. And if it doesn't make that, then that's the stuff that comes out and we ship it separately. Okay, so when we talk about it, it's not everything's going on site disposal. There's other stuff that doesn't meet disposal criteria that we ship elsewhere. Dispose of in a Nevada test site, in a fire care in Utah, we go out to somewhere else to treat it, and then dispose of. So that there's folks, there's an organization that goes, several organizations that go through, and that's what a lot of the folks are doing, going through and making sure that stuff meets certain criteria. And then it goes this way if it's that, it goes that way if it's another. So they check all the pipes. And I'll say, a lot of the pipes are pretty clean, okay? You know, that's probably, they not only survey with an instrument, but they have, there's a lot of borescopes that they use up there too. And if you ever used a borescope, do a visual inspection and you can kind of see, you know, anything that's residual on the inside.
Are they checking the employees pretty good? I mean, when you cut and cap them, you're really opening what's in that pipe out.
And we've had the folks come up and give a presentation on that, and so that's probably worthwhile again to have some of the folks from the cut and cap operation
come up, and
based on your questions, I'd say, hey, let's come up, because we've got new employees too.
Have
a presentation about what they do on cut and cap, give that some detail and special attention. And so I can give you a lot better answers than I can, and it'll be the people that actually do.
This is a different way to look at it. This is a part of our...
What else?
Orchestration and the basis of some of that.
Did I get through the rest? One more? Okay. So this is a different way to look at that same stuff?
This gets into the composition of that.
All right, and so this gets into... this is another way to check our performance. Okay, obviously that other thing said, hey, this is our plan, and you can kind of, that's something that you can measure. How far are we on cut and cap? This is a different way to look at it, and this says this is part of our technical orchestration and the basis of some of that plan. Okay, so you can, this is an interesting graph over time, and we talked about the cell when it's done is about 5 million cubic yards.
Actually, okay.
So this gets into the composition of that, knowing that the folks do a good job,
next slide,
calculating that 5 million, or it's on this slide, but it's farther to the right. So to give you the decoder ring for this on why it's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the cell design overall, you can kind of see how the liners are numbered, or the cells are numbered. So now if you go back and relate that to sequence, you can see why, they're gonna go after the first three liners, 1, 4, and 5. So that's part of the cell, complete cell that gets built first. Then they go back and do 2, 3, 6. Right. So there is a rhyme or reason to how they're planning to build this thing based on demolition and capacity. All right, so that's how you can tell where in the footprint work's going on. And then the other side of the shaded line says what's destined to go in it and the estimated volume for each, debris and soil. So again, this thing's really packed with a lot of information. And you can kind of, if you look at it for a while, you kind of get it, organized in your head. You kind of get a picture of really what the grand plan is at this site. I think there is one more. This next one is more about, this next one's more something that we use internally. So in our world, we'll talk about line item capital projects, we'll talk about capital asset projects, and what that just goes into is the different reporting chains we have to go through. Again, you'd think that as we progress, You know, we just talk about, you know, our reporting up to one organization. It's not quite that simple. We actually have to report to different organizations, essentially based on A, the color of the money, or the activity. And so we have line item capital projects, we have capital projects, and we have what we call operations activities. Okay, so this board is for us. Once you have this other stuff figured out, happy to tell you about this or get in detail on this one. If you jump to this one first, it will truly blow your mind, because we still struggle with it sometimes because some of the rules change on how our reporting, you know, upstairs goes. But that's what that is. Just a different slice, different way to look at it to facilitate some of the other folks that look at us in the department. And the other side of this thing just pulls out some major milestones. At the time, what we thought were major milestones, and again, we'll refine this a little bit more as we go through and update the life cycle baseline. You can see what the end state is. So if you said, if you went back and looked at that big chart, said, here's all the work I got to get done, and when I do it, and when I get to the end, that is the end state. Okay, so that's what the site will look like in 2034, or the date that we actually finish. So all that work compiled equals that.
Professor Spackies.
Fair. And so you can kind of see some of the what we have in major decisions, and just to give you, we talked about this in some of the previous meetings. WAC, CAMU standards in 2015, that was sorted. Records of decisions sorted. Hazard analysis done. So, and we talked about this, you know, things coming up in 16, final cleanup levels. So that's still up there. Working through the regulators on that. But, you know, reindustrialization, you know, helps you, you know, kind of zero in on what the risk-based cleanup levels are for that. But we'll be talking and presenting information to you guys relative to that stuff too.
Piece of cake, huh? All right, so that's a lot of information. A lot of information. All right, so Joel, if I were to take three big takeaways from that, and you jump in and correct me if I miss it. One is the lifestyle cycle baseline is this big area, but it's incredibly important, and we're much better off now that we have it than we didn't. And it looks like you incorporated a lot of feedback and input from the community and the SSAB in constructing it, and it's kind of the basis of going forward. Is that a fair one takeaway?
I would say, you know, before, you know, a while back, you know, hey, you know, I'm with the Department of Energy and I work for EM, Environmental Management. So now if I had to say what's the definition of the EM mission at the Torch Society, I go, you got it right here. Once we get through this stuff and decide to transition over to legacy management and EM, maybe at the DUS 6 plant, you know, we may have a mission over there, but relative to the GDP stuff, the EM mission would be.
I wondered about that. It's shown on there.
Okay. And having spending equal time at a site that doesn't have a lifecycle baseline, this is a huge deal. I mean, this is really makes things make sense. Okay, yeah, so Greg actually, on the actual life cycle baseline sheet, he circled the off-site disposition of
326.
You've got the seg shop potential construction, which might change depending on what Joel was saying. You've got the waste placement, the OSDF, containing landfills, are all things that the board made recommendations on. And, you know, I know it's a slow process, but you're seeing, you know, some fruit to that labor and this, you know.
You're seeing the tie of the landfills and plumes to the buildings, like Joel was saying. It's hard to see, you can't see the whole thing up there, but it's all connected.
So I would say the other thing, Joel, that I heard you say is In the past, we've been successful, and Stan's committee has done a great job knowing the right amount of money to ask for and how to go and ask for more money. It's equally important we get a little more sophisticated and ask for the right type of money, the right color of money, and making sure that we are, you know, just to throw more money at the project doesn't necessarily help us out long term. It's making sure we get the money in the right spot so that, and that's, as the board's developed, as the projects become more clear, it's easy for us to get more sophisticated now and to come across as a little more savvy in our requests and our recommendations, which play a big role, as you guys know. They get passed on to congressionals, they get passed on to community leaders who could trumpet those thoughts. And I think the other thing to really keep in mind is, it looks like the plan is for DOE to be here a while, right? And that's not a bad thing, but it might change thoughts and requests in your future planning of the site, you know, as you go forward, knowing that there's going to be an amendment going on 20 years from now, you know, 25 years. So that's a good anchor to have as you build around the central park.
So the other thing we have to, I guess, what is this important? So when we get asked to do our budget, portion of the what work we're going to get done in FY 15, 16, 17, whatever budget cycle we're on. So this is what we use to say, hey, you give us, for this amount of money, this is what we'll get done. So this is, we roll down exactly this and say, this is what we can do as part of the 16 requests, the 17 requests, the 18 requests. This is what we use to justify, our request, at least from the site level. And obviously that goes up and gets rolled around with everybody else's priority and go, hey, then this is what we got. And so this is also what we use to talk about impacts as well. So when somebody goes, now you've got only got this much money, we go, you know what? This is gonna be the impact. All right, so this is, again, this is important for us, right? This is what, we didn't really have anything like that before. Now we got it, and this is what we use. And so to the extent that you guys can look at that stuff and go, you know what? We think it's important to do this or this, or make sure you've got enough money for that, as part of the overall request, it really makes it, drives it home a little bit better.
All right, any questions for Joel on this? And it's okay not to have him tonight. We will talk about this many times going forward, so. In fact, we're gonna say something else, aren't we?
Would you like to have a committee report on the last committees we're supposed to have? It snowed.
It snowed. It did for all but one. All but one, and that was the executive committee where we primarily talked about this. That is the next item on the agenda. Will, is there anything you would like to add to the executive committee summary other than this discussion? We talked about the chair's meeting a little bit, but this
I wasn't in attendance, so I'm going to go ahead and defer to Mr. Berry.
That's correct. Everything pretty much that was discussed in the meeting has been discussed here tonight, mostly focused on the budget. Seem to be, lately, the site's in pretty good shape for the next couple of years. Anticipate this will be the first time in 3 years, I believe, that we've been warned that this is issued to any of the employees. I think the only wild card, they said possibly, is the new president has the right to go back in and review the budget and could possibly cut the funding to the site. However, I imagine that it's highly likely that the incoming president would try to review the previous budget. They'd probably focus on, more coming in. Talk about the National Chairs Meeting, which will be April 19th to the 21st in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, looking at sending quite a few board members to if we can get the energy going. And they did talk about the loss of funding for the Center Beach Plant of $50 million that will be retained at Oak Ridge. The layoffs have started for that side of the plant at this time. Discuss that, which I just talked about tonight, and then that's pretty much all that was discussed at the committee meeting. Anybody have any questions? Thank you very much.
Well done, sir. Good job. All right, we're going to slide forward into the public comment portion of the meeting. Julie's squaring away a microphone for us, but we might just have to have you talk really loud instead. So the only person I have that had signed up for public comment was Dr. Menuda. So sir, floor, if you'll introduce yourself, the floor is yours. I tell you what, why don't you step right up here to the table and grab this handheld mic? And we can turn that off just as easily. I'm kidding.
He didn't catch that.
Well, he wouldn't be the first to stop. Yeah, I'm David Wood, and I used to be a research staff member to a disciple who was operating, de facto chief scientist. So I try to attend as many of these meetings as I can when I'm not traveling. I've got obviously great interest in what goes on. And so, as you can see, I took copious notes. Item, and I've got five here. I want to direct this one to Alan, because you would ask about the trichloroethylene levels. Trichloroethylene is one of the densest solvents that was used. It was used in vapor degreasing back in the day for cleaning equipment. And because of that, gravity will cause it to migrate fairly deep into the soil. So one of the questions that I would direct to Joe would be, how deep are you going? Because normally it'll go down as far as until it hits rock, and then that's where the greatest concentration is going to be. And so depending on where the plume is and depending on where the rock is, we'll tell you how far down you need to go. Okay, second one, the site tours are always a good thing. And what I would recommend is that we find out who's on the appropriations committees in Congress and get them up here to ride the bus for an hour and a half. I traveled the country going to many of the nuclear sites doing expert work and consulting. And when you go to the Southwest, the impression is entirely different because of the situation with the uranium miners. And that actually factors into the bar, because they would prefer to have their miners mine rather than flood the market with bartered material. And again, having spent the better part of the last 30-odd years here, I think what's significant is this is a national security issue. This needs to be taken care of. And it's a whole lot easier to work with appropriated funds than it is to work with bartered funds. And somehow we can have our programs where our politicians are present, but they're not the ones who are controlling the purse strings and then getting the legislation to the president. So the best way to educate them is to get them here, have them ride the bus for an hour and a half, and get an idea of the huge size of this undertaking, because Joel, you've gone 10 years out, and there could be a great deal more than 10 years here. And anyway, so in terms of the global sense, I think that's important. Okay, now in terms of the equipment, I got a kick out of when you were discussing the 33 building converters, because you couldn't get a 33 converter through those doors. They're huge. And so it's a logistical nightmare to get cranes and other equipment that are large enough to move them around. So where they talk about some of the Air Force museums, where you put the airplane in and then build the building around it, that's basically how you have to deal with the 33 size converters. So that's an engineering and a logistical problem. But the issues in the 326 that were brought up were actually chemical problems and also radiation problems. As I noticed on one of the promo slides, you had a 25 size compressor. And the problem that you have with those compressors and then with the converters that work in tandem with those is that you will have much higher assay material potentially present. And that's especially if the heat was turned off, because when the facility was operating, the uranium compounds were vapors. You turn the heat off, they're going to condense. And so you have solid product all throughout there. And now, doing the non-destructive assay is good with the proviso that only solid uranium material is in the pipes. But unfortunately, there's also technetium in the pipes, and there's also arsenic in the pipes. And so part of the holdup, why the project is somewhat behind, is decisions have to be made on what do you do with the non-radioactive component, which is the arsenic, and then the technetium, which is radioactive, but it has, as Joel knows, it has a different type of radiation associated with it. So the issues there are not cookie cutter. And so if you're gonna do it right the first time, you need really to follow one of the seven habits, which is to solve the problem twice. Get it right on paper and then do it. Because if you go in and don't do it right, then you run the risk of getting a third generation of workers sick. And that's something that I think is very significant, and that we need to constantly remind people of, that this is not, say, retrofitting a dairy board. This is a major undertaking. Then there's also I think it's a great idea to go out to Fernald. And I'm thinking, because of the history at Fernald, where Lisa and her team had more or less just about wrapped up their work when this SSAB got started. So I think there's a nice relationship between what they were able to accomplish and what we may wish to accomplish. So learning as much as we can from them, I think, is very, very important. I would add to that, especially with the meeting coming up at Oak Ridge, is K-25 is now the East Tennessee Technology Park. It would be a good idea to see how much of that site you can visit to get an idea of what a formally operating gaseous diffusion plant can be. I don't want to use the word converted into, but maybe transitioned into. And then while you're down there, they have the Museum of Atomic Energy. And it's very worthwhile to visit that. And by that token, there's also a museum on site at Fernald. And then if you're doing day trips, certainly a trip to Mound would be good, where again, they have a museum and you can see how that site was cleaned and buttoned up. And then if you want to take a somewhat longer trip, they did an amazing job cleaning up Weldon Spring in the St. Louis area. So it's, to me, it would be important to get that more global look at what's going on at other sites. So that rather than reinvent the wheel, you see what the others have done. And then, you know, imitation is the sincerest part of flattery, because what you can use from, or reuse in this case, from the sites that have already been through this, I think is pretty important. And then I alluded a little bit to the cut and cap and some of the issues in 326, and I'm very appreciative of the different colors of money, because you don't want to get into the accounting hassle of taking money from the wrong pot. Now, what we do in private business enables us to pay suppliers and vendors, but I know not to do that in the world that Joel travels in. And so when I saw that complete that chart that you have, that's an impressive piece of work. And so you and your team ought to be very, very proud of that. And so just looking at that, when you do bring in the cap and cut people, I'm hoping that you may bring in some of the steel workers who are actually doing the work on a daily basis, because that's where the rubber meets the road. Because even though I do consulting now, I still get calls from the workforce saying, what do we do with this situation? And so again, we, especially now where there aren't very many people left who were at the site when it was operating. So when you send somebody to work, they're not bringing all the baggage that somebody like Hardwood or somebody like me would bring. And because of that, you don't want to get younger people sick or expose younger people unnecessarily. Because it, as I mentioned, it doesn't have to be radioactive to hurt you. The arsenic compounds will get you. And so with that in mind, again, I know people want to go home, and I think, I'm hoping that these comments are helpful. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. All right, any final comments from the board? All right, you guys have whooped. Hey, Julie got a message on her phone. There is a weather advisory 3 to 4 inches before 11 tonight. So. No, serious. So be careful. So when you be careful going home. If you're going to gallivant around town all night, we hope that you're home.
Way to dive me out, brother.
All right, anything else? Anybody else? Thank you, guys. Well,
return.